In this video, I'm going to share 10 must-know tips and tricks that you can apply to your winter photography. Because finally, after 2 years, we have got some snowfall in Denmark. It obviously only lasted for a couple of days, but nevertheless, I did manage to get out and take a few photos. So let's start in the field. So the first tip is to go to a place where there are snow. I know this sounds like a stupid tip, because obviously, but what I mean is that obviously in Denmark we don't get like the same amount of snow all over the entire country. So yesterday I was looking at our weather service, the radar service, to determine where I should go tomorrow, which is today, about where there would be most snow. On top of that, I actually also used the webcams of the road services we have for highways around Denmark. Not just highways, other ways also. Just to confirm whether or not there were like snow on the trees. So I went to a part of the country, which is the western part of Jutland. And I come to this plantation, which looks just super, super beautiful. So the second tip, I've talked about it before on this channel, but it is just so utterly important for your photography, and that is to have a strong subject or an interesting subject, or find out what it is you want to photograph or document. It can be a tree, a house, a church, waterfall, glacier, whatever. The point is just that it stands out in the photo and the viewer shouldn't be in doubt about what it is you're photographing. It's not just like a beautiful view from a hilltop. Like it needs to have that subject, that focal point, that anchor that the eye just cannot not see. So I've been driving a little bit around in this plantation, and I've come by this rather aesthetic oak tree. Also a rather young oak tree, I think, but it's rather aesthetic. It's nice and gnarly. And like you can see here, so the stump is pretty good, but it has a lot of nice branches. And because it's snow covered, it actually stands out pretty good compared to the background. Now I'm shooting this one at either f8, f11 or f16. Simply just to have different amounts of blur in the background. And then I will decide when I come home in front of the computer which one I prefer the most. I'm also getting both a horizontal and a vertical. So besides that one simple focal point or obvious focal point, which can be, yeah, as I said, a tree, a church, car, whatever you're photographing, actually taking a photo of, we can also move a little bit more into the abstract part of photography. And especially during winter, abstract photos just pops up everywhere. In this particular case here, I am simply just photographing this row of trees here, and I'm zooming in to somewhat like that area there. And as you can see here, it has a really nice repetition of pattern from here and here and here and here. And even though there's not like one specific focal point, like that is where you should see, it still has that very aesthetic quality to it with all this repetition, with black and white and black and white and black and white. And we can all see it's trees, so we can fairly easily recognize what it is we're looking at. So yeah, that went well. I had to get the car to the mechanic, so that day was cut short, sadly. So I'll take the rest of it from here in the studio. So if you're so lucky that you get enough snow that it covers all the ground, you can really just drive out and pursue some really beautiful winterish minimalist photos. Just go for like field poles that sticks up of the snow, lone trees and so forth. In this photo here, I have photographed the lighthouse Rubjerknude, which is just standing lonesome in what seems to be a snowfall. And in this photo here, I was just driving along the road in Iceland and I managed to capture this photo of these horses, which is just running along this mountainside. And of course, this one, the black lone church in Iceland, which is just surrounded by a beautiful, calm snowfall. Now, I didn't really get to do a whole lot of local snow photography because there was basically no snow in my part of Denmark, but I have pre-visualized quite a lot of different scenes that I want to capture when there will be enough snow. Hopefully it will happen this winter. And here are a few examples of these, with this one lone tree here, and then of course also this scene here with the two trees next to each other. The fifth tip is to apply some holistic thinking. And holistic thinking is that the whole photo is greater than the sum of its parts. Think of it as a big puzzle. When the puzzle is complete, it shows a beautiful picture. And even though it is contained of all these small individual puzzles, all these pieces are not really interesting in themselves. They need to come together to make the final puzzle, for it to actually be something worth looking at. So the individual elements in the photo doesn't have to be super interesting in and of themselves, but when you put them together, it looks really, really beautiful. In this example here, which is one of the most iconic landscape photos in contemporary landscape photography, we have the waterfall and we have the mountain. The waterfall in and of itself is fine. The mountain in and of itself is rather iconic because it has the shape it does, but when you put them together, they really are much greater than the sum of the two individual parts of the photo. Adding elements together, of course, requires some sense of order, and order and composition in photography goes hand in hand. Now, I have made a lot of videos about composition in landscape photography, but if you want to learn even more, be sure to get my two ebooks, which is all about composition in landscape photography. In these ebooks, I cover many different topics, and in the final chapter, I sum the entire book up and give some examples where I put it all together. If you're not sure whether or not you want these ebooks, be sure to check out the light versions first. They are free and you can get them through the links in the description.
So the sixth tip is to use different shutter speeds if it is snowing. So using a fast shutter speed, like 1/500th of a second, you can really capture all the individual snowflakes in one go, and it gives like a really kind of raw stillness to the photo. Of course, relative to the scene you're photographing. This photo here from Londranga in Iceland, which is my personal favorite photo of all the photos I've got from this viewpoint. You can really see how this individual snowflakes works really well with this beautiful raw scene. If you slow the shutter speed down to around 1/40th of a second or thereabouts, you can capture the snow with a long exposure effect, so you get some really nice streaks of the falling snow. That was the effect I applied to the Black Church photo, as you can see here. It kind of tames the photo, yet it still implies that there is a snowfall going on, kind of a heavy snowfall going on. So in that way, you can both capture the rawness, but also kind of get some stillness and still showing that it is snowing. And with a long exposure, like 15 or 30 seconds, you can actually emulate fog and add a lot of atmosphere to your photos. That's exactly what I did with these two photos, one from Aldeafoss in Iceland and the other one from Stuxnes, also in Iceland. And it was actually such a heavy snowfall that I had to dehaze the photos quite a bit and add some contrast, simply just to add some depth and texture. So the seventh tip is kind of the same as what I mentioned in last week's video. When you're photographing in a relatively flat scene, like in a foggy scene or in a scene with a lot of snow, be sure to exposure compensate with about one stop towards right, so that you are overexposing a little bit. The camera has a tendency, or the camera is designed, to capture around 50% gray, right there in the middle. So if you don't want your photos and the snow in the photos to be gray, then you have to give it a little bit more on the exposure side. Now, this is not super duper crazy important when we do digital photography, because you can fairly easily just compensate for this in post-processing and add a little bit more brightness to the photo. And when you do edit photos like these in Photoshop or Camera Raw or Lightroom, you can just change the backdrop to white. In that way, you can fairly easily eyeball whether or not you think that your whites in the photos, the snow or the fog, is either too bright or too dark. The eighth tip is all about being prepared and getting out and being the first on location when it is snowing or if there has been a snowfall, especially at the well-visited and iconic locations. Now, this is a good idea in, let's say, most of the big locations in Iceland, but it is also what happened for me, because I actually went out a few days after I recorded the first part of this video to a forest in northern Denmark. It is a very well visited forest, and I have been there a few times already. I've showed in the videos on this channel, but the problem is that there had been no new snow falling, so there was just full of footprints, and you could really see that it has been well visited during the days with snow. So I should probably just have gone there on the first day of snowfall instead of heading to that other location that I showed in the beginning of this video. The ninth tip is to make sure to not just stick to one focal length. So on this same day, I was just walking around trying to find some compositions, and by the life of me, I just couldn't find anything to photograph. I was using my new Tamron 28-200mm. I will talk about that lens in a future video, and I just couldn't find a proper composition. In the end, towards sunset, I found one location that might work with the wide-angle lens, so I put on my 12-24mm lens and just shot this shot here at 12 millimeter. It is not the best winter photo that I've ever photographed, but everything considered, I'm pretty happy with how it turned out. So make sure to have a lot of different focal lengths that you can work with when doing winter photography. The 10th and final tip, well, before the bonus tip, is to use a drone. Obviously, when the landscape changes due to snow, the perspectives that you can get from the air will also be vastly different relative to when there is no snow. And that was exactly what I wanted to do at this forest here, where I could get some straight down shots of the trees where all the snow were laying on all the branches. I really think that these straight down photos here turned out really well. And the bonus tip is to make sure to leave all your camera gear in your backpack when you're done photographing and you're coming home and taking it inside. If you're just opening your camera bag and all your gear is cold, the moist in the air will condensate on your camera, and there is a small risk that if you turn on your camera, you can short circuit the camera. So better not to risk it. I usually leave my camera gear for a couple of hours in the bag before I take it out. So if you want to learn how I edit my photos, be sure to enroll in my huge 28 plus videos post-processing course, Photoshop for Landscape Photographers. In this course, I will show you how to use the programs, curate your photos, use luminosity masks, do focus stacking, do focal length blending, add glow and atmosphere, make high contrast photos, avoid unwarranted editing mistakes, and much, 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 much more. Be sure to check out the links in the description for both the ebooks and the course, and remember to apply the coupon code for the course to get 15% off. As always, I would highly appreciate both a like and a comment. Subscribe to the channel if you really enjoyed the video. It is the easiest way to show the YouTube algorithm that this is a video worth showing to others. So, thank you so much for watching. See you next week.